Hello everybody, in this tutorial I will present you how I've created a project in WebDimpro, also with FPM OVP configuration. For any question you can subscribe me on this mail. Okay, first I will present you the functional part of this project. This project is divided into two parts, into user and into administration. First of all, you go to the register, you can enter your name, your last name, password, other things, and then you will be registered in the database. Then a user need to give you permission to can register in this site, and here you are as an administrator. You select the user, then you can go to change the type of the user, because first time it's no type to the user, and you can put it as an user or as an administrator. Also very nice functionalities with these pop-ins. I will show you how they are created. Also hiding the layout and displaying it. Also very nice functionalities. You copy the rows from an Excel and you paste it here. Also some GUIBBs I will present you, pop-ups. It will contain everything, this tutorial. Everything, and also it has a very good architecture. And also when you log out, you can log out and save the data, or log out without saving the data, because you cannot save the data in the database every time you change something, or because it's not performant, and every modification are stored in objects, and just when you go out they are saved. I will show you how we will do this. And if we go as a user, okay, the password is not okay, now it's okay. We can buy a product also by pressing this button, also by drag the row and drop it here in this basket. Now we can go inside this page, and here we can make some operation. We can delete the project, the product, we can pay the product, we can delete all, we can do what do we want with this product. And also we can see all the products that were bought by the user until this moment. Also these are some dynamic navigation links. They are created dynamic in the WebDo modified method, and also this navigation from to the other view, it is created dynamic. And we can see that this is the FPM toolbar, and I will show you also how we create this FPM. First time I think I will start with this part. How can we create an FPM? To start an FPM configuration, you need to go to the FPM OVP component, right click, create an FPM OVP component, and then you just need to go in your configuration. It will open this configuration. Okay, and here in this FPM OVP configuration we can create a page. We can assign it an ID and also a title of the page, because this is the title, what title we have done here. Okay, there are several properties that we can select them here. From example, to give an application controller on this one. And also other things. But we can go to this Hauptseite. We will go down and we can see that we can add a section, and in this section we can then add a new IBB. Adding a new IBB, a freestyle component UIBB, means that we add a WebDimpro component and the window of the WebDimpro component. And in our case, we have selected this component to be displayed here. And yep, this one was selected here. And also to be the first page which will run on this FPM configuration, you just need to flag this checkbox and then it will run this page with this configuration ID. Okay, let's see how application it's created. Okay, we go to the leading application and we will see that we need to use this FPM OVP component and also just this. Then we need to go to the component controller. In the component controller, we just need to go in the Vdoo init and to write some code. We need to use here to declare that we use this OVP component in the component controller. Okay, we need the key. We give the key to our created FPM configuration and then we just create the component. Then we go to the view and in the main we just embed the view container UI element. Then we go to the window and then we embed our FPM OVP component in this view container UI element. And then we will be sure that our FPM configuration with the embedded UIBBs will run. Okay, so this is with the leading application component. Now we have seen here that we have the ZNet Shop login component. Okay, let's go to this component to see how it is created. ZNet Shop login. Okay, we have created in our component a very interesting thing. It is that we just need to use the FPM UI building block to run this inside an FPM configuration. Okay, we can see how the view it's painted. Okay, and we will go inside the login action. Here inside the login action we see that we pass the context to this method of the assistance class. Also this assistance class can be created here by entering the name of the class and just pressing enter. Okay, and then let's go inside this user method to see what operations are done. Okay, we take the node with the name from the context, we store it in a node reference. Okay, we get the element, we call the getStatic attribute to take all the structure for this node name. Okay, and then we make the checks. We check the internal table because first time in the Vdoo init we make a check, we make a load of the data just one time and then we work just in memory. Okay, then we create an object. We create this object because we want to have the object stored and then to pass the object like a parameter, because it is more performant to pass a object reference. Okay, then if the user return, if this user return true, we set this object in a transport data class. This transport data class, we can use it in other components. It's just a mode how we can transport the data. This is the first mode, and we have also a second mode, because if we are inside the FPM, because we can run this application also if we are not in FPM configuration, I will present you a little bit later. We can see how we can navigate with FPM. We can navigate with FPM. Okay, and look, we can create an object which has the type CLFPM parameter. Okay, we can set the values and also give we need to give the change content area parameter and also an ID. This ID means that we will go to the Hauptseite, to the page 2 or to the page 3 of this FPM configuration. This means, and then we can load some parameters here on this FPM parameters, and then we can handle it in the FPM event loop as we want. Okay, this is the second transport data mode. The third transport data mode, it is through the interface controller. Okay, and here we see that we want to take the admin component or the main component. To do this thing, we just need to make in the admin component, we just need to be sure that in the component controller of the component we need to flag this interface to be marked as a public. If we have checked this flag as a public, then we are sure that this method can be called outside other component. But for this, we just need to declare our usage that we use this component. And also for the main component, we do the same thing. We just make an interface, not an interface, a method, and we flag this method to be an interface method. Okay. Also, this is the third transport mode, and the fourth transport mode can be if we navigate from a component to another component. And this can be done very easy. For this, we just need to declare a view. Okay, we declare the view, admin view. We need to go to the layout, and we will see here that we have a view container UI element. Okay, we have this element. Then we need to go to the window and to say that we will embed in our admin view, we will embed our admin component. Okay, we embed this one. Then we just need to make an outbound plug in our main view and to bind this outbound plug to this inbound plug. And then when we press this button and we are not in a FPM configuration, then we can go to the other component and we also can change some data. Okay, this is the fourth mode. The fifth mode to exchange data through the components in this system, it is through an application controller. You define a application controller class And these methods need, this component needs to implement two interfaces. Okay, it implements these two interfaces, and then it will have a lot of methods because they are from the interface. And then we can go here in the component configuration, and in this, on this button, we can give for this component configuration this control class. We can give also a WebDimPro component, and we can give also an ABAP object class. And then on every interaction of any button from our application, we will go through some methods. For example, we will go to the override event OVP, to before process event, to before process before output, when we will trigger a button. Okay, we will see. I've showed you here how we can transport the data to a component to another component, but also how we can navigate from a component to another component. Okay. Let's see. Then I've presented you the first component. Let's now go to the second page, which contains two sections. Okay, and these two sections contains just two UIBBs. And the first section contains a UIBB with this name. We copy this name and we go to the other mode. We enter the component and let's see this component what has. It has the implemented interface to run inside the FPM loop. Okay. And it's just this simple component. Also, because it appears in this left area, we can see it. We can see that it's nothing embedded here. Okay, let's go to the second section and to the second UIBB. Let's copy this component. Let's paste it and let's see what it has. Aha, okay, it has an assistance class. This assistance class, it is also used in the ZNet Shop login component, because you delegate business logic from the component to the assistance class. This is the design pattern, the model view controller. The controller should be an assistance class. Okay, and let's see what do we have in this component. Of course, because it is a component which run inside the FPM configuration, needs to have this EFIPM UI building block implemented. And then we can go to see how the main looks like. Okay, the main looks like this. We see here that we have a view container UI element header container. Okay, and we can go to the window to see if it is something embedded here. And it's the main, okay, header container, okay, and we can see that it is embedded this component, ZNet Shop header. Okay, this component is this one. Let's see how it look like. Okay, and this header component looks like this. Okay, this header components had also a custom controller, and this custom controller, then it was changed to a configuration controller, because this configuration controller, it is used then in this component configuration. Okay, and it has a node properties with an attribute is visible. Okay, let's run this component configuration to see how it looks like. Okay, we have start the configuration. Let's go in this configuration. Okay, we can see because we defined that custom controller as a configuration controller node, we have this node which has this attribute is visible, and we can use this is visible, we can flag it, or we can do other things with it. Okay, and this has also an application configuration which was created by pressing this button. Let's see also how this looks like. Okay, so we can see that this application configuration has our previous configuration, component configuration, assign it. We assign it just from this button. Okay, and now we can see that if we go to the test, we can test our application. And also we can change some, we can make it visible or not visible, we can go back, we can save the data, okay. And for this application configuration, we just assigned a WebDIM Pro component. Yeah, we just assigned this application configuration to our window. And that's it with this header. This header has also something on the view, these fields. And we want it to when we log in, we want to have this data for the user here. For this thing, we just need to use an interface controller method setData, and accordingly to this setData method, we set the data to the context, and then the context is binded to the main, and then it's created a formulary container according to this node. Okay, we have also an assistance class, and if we go to the video doing it, we can see what is it inside. Also, this mechanism, it is for all the components. Here in the video doing it methods, we take the reference of the message manager, we store it in the systems class or in the component controller attribute, we get the FPM and the OVP to set it, because also we can take the window manager, and also in some components we take the context and we enable the context changelog to see what modification are to the views. Because we take here first time our objects, and then we use them where do we want. Okay, this is with header. We can have also a look in our VDDoInit component controller shop main, and you will see that it has also the same things. It takes just one time the message manager, the FPM OVP, the window manager, the context change log, and also it creates the header component. It fills the header component with data. Set the data. Okay, and also another very nice thing, it is that we can in the main we can make that drag and drop operation, which is nice. For this we just need to insert a drag source info in our table. We need to be careful to put here a name which will correspond to the drop target info. We need to put also here the same name, and if we specify this, we can drag our lines, and then in the drop we just need to implement a method which verifies if there are data in the context. If there are, we read from the internal table memory. This is like in Java, and it works. I like this very much. And then we just put the line in an internal table, and then we will use it a little bit later if we want to buy this product. We do the same operation by pressing this buy product button, and we also display a message. Okay, so this was and I told you about the navigation link, which are created dynamically, and also then how it is the navigation done. It is done in the VDDo modified view, in this one it has some parameter first, and there are by the framework. And if it is first time, we take our element group. Okay, we take all the controllers, this means all the views, but not the main, the other one, and then we loop over them and we put a condition just where is cat, because we want just on this cat, phone cat, photo cat, and IT cat to create the link. We create the link to action. Okay, we put them in the metric set data, we add them to the child, we make a description, we create a URL, and also we add some icons. Okay, and then we make the navigation possible, and also the navigation, it is possible because we need first to implement an action here to test. We just need to have it declared here. We can implement it a little bit later, and a little bit later you will see that because of this code the navigation will work dynamically. And yes, we make also then some checks here to enable and to disable a link. And this one, these checks are for when we don't have any product, we don't want to have this navigation link, because of this are those checks done. Okay, and when we go to the to test, okay, I've showed you this code, do dynamic navigation. And also in the byproducts we have some buttons, for example the delete product button. Okay, let's go inside them and to see what happens. Okay, so opens an open pop-up. Okay, and this open pop-up method, it is a method from the view. Okay, it puts here a header. We take the message manager from the systems class, we create a pop-up to confirm. Okay, we subscribe to, we open the window, and we also subscribe to events button. But be careful, because we really need to write these methods, because if we will not write them, then we will have a problem. It will not we will have a short dump, an error we will have if we not implement this action here, del1prod pop-up and no del1prod pop-up. We need to write them here. And because of this, when we delete a product, go this view, delete a product, it will appear a pop-up. And if we go to the yes button, then we will go to this action, del1prod pop-up, and let's see here what it happens. Okay, we read with the wizard the context node. Now with the wizard, let's, now we are in edit mode, we have the wizard. Okay, we just read from the context the byte products, the byte products. Okay, and then we loop over, no we don't loop, we just delete from the internal table where the key of the selected products, it's the same from the key from the internal table, and then we just make a bind table and we will have our new table. This describe table, okay, it will told us how many lines has this table in this system variable. Okay, we take the node, and also these are some checks to display or not the navigation link from the go to the byte product. Okay. Also we have a pay product button. Let's see how this works. Okay, this is a very interesting thing. We raise an FPM event parameter. Okay, we create the object, we put the value, and then we raise an event by ID. Okay, and this raising of event is sketched in the FPM event loop in our component controller in the method process event. Yes, because we had the EvoPay pop-up, the event ID. Okay, we get the keys in an internal table. We see if we have a value like this one. Okay, we see, we take the value. If it is open pop-up, we raise an WebDimPro event. Okay, and by raising of this WebDimPro event, we just, I think this fire pay pop-up all event, pay pop-up all. Okay, and this it will be handled in this view here, pay pop-up all. Okay, it will open a pop-up. It's a little bit, of course it could be done more easy, but I want it also to play with the FPM raising events and also with the WebDimPro events. Okay, then it will open a pop-up, but it will open as a window. So we need to see this window, which pop-ups embed. So it embeds the pop-up pay. Okay, we go in this view. We see that we have two buttons. If we want to pay the pop-up, if no, I think it will just cancel the, it will just close the window. Yes. Let's go to the pay. Pay all products, and we will see that we make a fire to pay all events, which it is also handled in this byproducts in pay all, and here we just make the business logic to pay a pop-up, and then we will go back to the previous page. But now we have deleted. If we buy one, we have it here, we pay the product, and we test the system told us how much do we have to pay, and then we just press the pay and we go again to the previous view. Okay. This was with this one. Another button, it is to delete all. We just clear everything from the context. We also have subscribed to two events, and let's go directly to the events. If we suppose we delete all pop-up, yes, it will make a clear to the internal table and also to the context table. It will be an empty table. Okay. So this is with this view. Another interesting view, it's the C user products, because this C user products, we will see here that of course it embeds the header container, but it embeds also an other component, the self-vd table component, which allows us to create an ALV grid, and for this we just need to say that we use this component here. Okay, we can go also to the ALV interface controller usage, and if we go to user product and we take this user product, we take it to the data, then we will have external context mapping. This it will be an external context mapping. Okay. But of course we can have also other possibilities to set the data to the ALV component. First we need to create it, because if we call a method of the interface controller without creating the component, then we will have a short dump. But now it's okay, we take the usage component and we can put the note, we take the note, we pass the note reference, and then we can, then the framework will do automatically for us the filling of the data of the LV grid. Okay, so in big lines I think this is all with this component. We can go to main, and here we will see that we have, let's go first to the component configuration to see how this was created. This is the admin page 3, and here we will see that we have three sections, a master page section and two other sections. And we will take first the component ZNet shop admin. Okay. We go to this one, and of course this one will have also the EFFPM UI building block, and then we will have these three components. In the main we see that we have two view container UI elements which will embed a ZNet header component, the first view container UI element, and the second view container UI element will embed the container main. And let's go to the add products, because here are lots of new functionalities. A table pop-in, for example, you just add a new column. In this column you just add a table pop-in, also a navigation link with an icon to have this nice pencil, and then you just need to fill a form container accordingly to the line, or what do you want to have here? I don't know. Then you just need to go to the table and to make also this property selected pop-in. In this node you also need to add an attribute of type string to have this pop-in open, to know which line of the table it is opened. And anything else, it will be that we have also a lots of buttons which will delete a product. We can see them here. We can delete, for example, this product. It will appear a pop-up. It is also built like the previous one. Delete product, deletes all the product, this one. Okay. Also we can add a product and it will appear a pop-up, and we can add the product, we can clear all the fields, and we can save all the products, all the modification of the products. And this thing, it is done very simple, just by calling a method of the assistance class which calls a function module, and in this function module we just save our product. But to have here in this method, to have the modified objects, we need to go to the close opin method. It have a close popin method, and when we close the popin is this thing from here. When we close it, we just need to call a method of the build context change log and the process context change log. To can call this method, we just need in the component controller in the vdo init to get the context, to store it in a place, and then to enable the context change log. And then we can call these two methods, build context change log, which just put in an internal table the new modification of the views, if there were any modification. And then with the process context change log, we just loop over the changed elements. And if they are changed, we create an object and we store it in an internal table. Okay. And then we can also fire a webdimpro event that the product was changed. Let's see how this looks like. Okay. Something changed is the name of event. Let's see if it is implemented here. No, it's not implemented here. Maybe in the main, yes, something change of the component controller, which just display a message accordingly to which parameter we put to it. Okay, the how the pop-ups are opens are the same like the previous. It's not big deal, but I will present you another new functionality with the copy and the paste of the product. We can take we can copy from an Excel and then just to paste here our data. And the Excel needs to have the ID product, product name, price, and ID category column. And how this is implemented, we will see it here. You just need to make an input field, not a text view. You have also this event method, multi-value paste. And on this method, you just loop over the table with data and accordingly to this business logic, you assign every data to the columned field, and then at the end of row you just append the structure to the internal table. Okay, now just let's the save products behaves also. It just save all the products or the table it takes from the object. But we see here that we have also this toolbar FPM button, logout with save. This is handled in the component controller in a process event method. Because we analyze it in the FPM change content area, because if we go to schema Drucktaste, here we see that we have some buttons, and we can see that we have logout, and logout contains several buttons, from example with save and without save, and we have assign the FPM change content area event ID. But we have also put some parameters on the parameter name logout. We put the parameter value logout no save and logout save. And because of this, when we are in the FPM change content area and we have the value 1, okay, we get the value from the parameter value, and if it is logout no save, no action. And if it is log safe, we just call these two methods of the database, and we work very very good here in performance, because we need to make just one save to the database, not interact every time with the database, because it's not performant. Okay, let's see something else. Okay, this is a tree. I can show you how it is created. We just need to go to the component configuration and to see which component do we have in this left part. Okay, we go to the schema overview and here we see that we have on the ZNet shop left admin area. Okay, let's see it here. Okay, we see that inside the main we had added a tree and this tree it's binded to this node, and inside this node we have a supply function assigned to this one, and because of this you can see this user operation field. And then if we go back to the layout, not to the context, and we go back again, we can see the supply function which has this views, add user, sell user, delete user, change type user. Okay, because of this we have the tree, and then we assign an action to this, to every text, and then this one are analyzed here. When we are on this ID, we make a raising of a fire outbound plug here, or here, or here. Okay. Then we just need to present you this JoyBB, how it's created. This JoyBB is created. If we go to component configuration, we see here that, okay, this one, I added from this button a list component, and then I have these two fields automatically filled. Then I just need to give here a name and then to go to UIBB configuration. Then I will enter here, but to enter here I need to give a feeder class first time, and this feeder class we can see it here. Okay, we take the feeder class. Okay, we take the feeder class, and this feeder class needs to implement these two methods. And accordingly to these methods, we will have some methods inside here. And because of the get definition data, we will take dynamically the structure, we will create a field catalog, then we will change some additional columns. Okay, and we also assign an event to the ID user. And in the process event, we will see that when we are in this event, clicking on the column, okay, it will be analyzed here and it will be raised an event, open dialog box, which will open a dialog box just with the ID. But for this, we just need to give here our we need to have a dialog faster. And then yes, in this JoyBB, accordingly to this definition, we will add the columns. They will be created automatically. We just need to take them with drag and drop. And then ID user, other things, we need to make it link to action. And this is all with this JoyBB. Okay, let's go back to see how it looks like the dialog. It's a dialog box which has the page ID 7. Okay, and this page ID 7 has just the UIBB, and this UIBB contains also a tree with these two types. Okay. Also, this set visible manage product area, I remember from them, they are done in the application controller class. Yes, they are done in the application controller class. In the component controller, in the override event OVP. Okay. We will see that if we go to the configuration, to the schema overview, you will see that this button, let's see this one. Okay, it has the event ID set to IPB admin visible. Okay, it's not a standard FPM ID, it's just created for us, okay. And this standard event FPM ID, it is analyzed here. We take the section, we loop over them. If we are in the section 1, we take the UIBBs for this section, we loop over the UIBB, and if it is our component, we just make a flag visible above true or above false, it depends, and then we call the method change UIBBs, and then we will have our UIBBs to the context. Also, this display the left page section, it is a button that hides automatically for us the left page section. We don't need to do anything else. Okay, so I think this is all. We have also here an UIBB from this pop-up. You can open automatically from a button. Let's see if we are in the, or if we go up here, we can see that we have this button. Okay, we put this FPM open dialog, and on the scope page we put page 6, then the system will automatically open our dialog box with ID page 6. We don't have to do nothing else. The other thing that we do here, it is that we use a formulary UIBB. Okay, so this formulary UIBB was created by from this button introduct freestyle component, not a freestyle component, a formulary component. And then we will have these two fields automatically filled, and then we will just type our configuration ID, and we will go to UIBB configuration, and of course the system will ask us for a feeder class. We need to give the feeder class which implements the interface EFFPM UIBB form, and we can see the feeder class for this configuration. Okay, we will see that it has also a method, and in the get definition method we see that we take the structure, we make some modification to the fields, and then we add just two buttons, and these two buttons, it will be, they will be analyzed in the get data, and they will insert the user to the database or not. Here you can also with the FPM event loop inside these methods. We are inside the FPM event loop. Okay, I presented you this functionality, how we open a thing, and also a new functionality, it is that you can make a schema wire UIBB. For this schema, your wire UIBB, you just need to... This is the Hauptseite for schema wiring with UIBB. Okay, and we can see that we have two GUIBBs, a formulary component and a list GUIBB, and these two are binded together. Okay, as you know, a formulary component, you insert it from this formulary component button, then the list component, you introduce it for from this list component. You need to give them formulary a configuration name, and then you just press the UIBB configurator. The system asks you for the feeder class. Accordingly to the get definition method, you will have the fields. And to make this wiring, you just need to go to the wire schema and to add the wire. But till you can add the wire, you need also to make a connector class and also a container class. This connector class needs to have these three interface, also a container which has this type, and this class, we can see that it has just these two attributes, just a container to transport some data, nothing more. Okay, this class constructor, we give him a namespace, and also we need to implement some methods. We need to implement the setInput method to set the container, and also the getOutput method, and also a class constructor, yeah, to the namespace, but I told you. And then you just need to see what the feeder class has inside. For example, we go to the first GUIBB, which is the formulary GUIBB. You go to the feeder class. Okay, let's take the class, let's put it here, and in the method we will see that it has also this feeder model interface implemented, and we take the namespace, we take the output, and we put also here a key. This key don't appear here, but it will appear, you can see. Let's go to wire schema. Okay, and form listed, and this it will appear in the ZCL rent list. Oh no, we will see exactly which is the class. Okay, we need to implement this method, this and this method, and the GUIBBs just need this interface, need to implement the getData method. We will make also a raise an FPM event. Okay, but if you want to find more about this wiring, write me and I will make then another tutorial. This is just a nice short introduction about the project and what you can do. And let's see the second one. Let's see what feeder class has and what methods has that feeder class implemented. Come on, go to okay, let's see the feeder class, the current list. Okay. Ah, it's not a WebDimpro component, I forgot to change it to a class. Okay. It has the feeder model. The feeder model the namespace, the output, and because of this we have that identifier. You can see this identifier here. Okay, get output data, make also a connector, and in the get definition we make the definition of the fields to have the fields in the configuration. Okay, in the process event we don't do nothing. In the get data we just refresh with the new data if it is necessary, or if it is the first time we make, yeah, this select is not good to have it here. This data is just a transport data class which has some methods to add the product. The class constructor get all the data and store it in an attributes, get product by index, get all, get product by ID, is it dirty, if something's remove to delete, set the dirty and update. Okay, I will make also a very short overview of the data model. I should start with this, but I will present you very quick also the data model, the main table of the data model. Okay, I will start with the user table. We have these fields with the type. If we go to technical setting, we see that it is a buffer table and it is fully buffered. I think it's not a good idea to have this table buffered because lots of users can register to our sites if we have success, and then it's not okay to use a buffer table if you change the data very often, but I will change it. Okay, also another thing was to the database specific properties. If you will use HANA in the very short future, you need to have this flag set it. Okay, index, we don't have any index. The primary index are just the key index, and this is all. Okay, the second table is the product table with this type, and this basket table, it's a relational table because these two are foreign key. We can see here that is a foreign key to this table, and this one is a foreign key to this table, to this user table, and also cardinality properties. And we have also a view to join the user which bought a product. Okay, thank you very much, and if you have any question you can write me on this email address. Me and my colleague Diana McAvey can explain. Have a nice day. Bye.